you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you.
Good morning and welcome to Prayer and Devotion. We ended our worship yesterday with Lord, I Need You, and we're starting our time together with Matt Marr's version of Lord, I Need You. It is good to be with all of you today. I want to take a minute and welcome you. I think we're having some glitchy issues because I've got people coming on and off and on and off, but I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you found us this morning. So let me say good morning, Gail and Michelle, holding you both in prayer. I'm glad you're here. Good morning, Desmondette and Myrna. Welcome. Holding you in prayer today. I'm glad you're here. Good morning, Barbara and Priscilla. Holding you both in prayer today. Good morning, Cami and Donna. I'm glad you're here, holding you in prayer. Good morning, Celia and Joanne. It's good to be with you today, holding you in prayer. Good morning, Andrew and Minda and our group. I love that. I'm glad you're both here, holding you in prayer. Good morning, Esther and Susan, holding you in prayer today. Good morning, Renetta. All right, itchy nose. Renetta and Siege and Betty, holding you, all of you in prayer today as well. It is good to join together with you in this season of Lent. And I've moved over to a new book, which is entitled Show Me the Way, which is a Lenten devotion based on the writings of Henry Nouwen. Yes, my husband told me yesterday, you do too much Henry Nouwen, but I love the stuff that he writes. It always really touches my heart. I think he is, I always enjoy what he writes. Good morning, Rosetta. I'm glad you're here, holding you in prayer today. So today's devotion comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4. And I'm going to be reading verses 8 through 10, and this is Matthew's version of a part of the temptation of Jesus in the desert during the 40 days following his baptism. Good morning, Christiana. I'm glad you're here holding you in prayer today. So if you want to open up your Bibles and turn to Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4, I'll be reading verses 8 through 10. So as you are opening up your Bibles, my name is Cindy Stouffer. I'm blessed to be the pastor at the United Methodist Church at New Brunswick. And it is good to be able to gather with you. We've been doing this, oh gosh, I don't know exactly. I know it started in Lent. I just don't remember when Lent started last year. So it's almost been a year. It's almost been a year that we've been gathering for this time. And I'm glad you're with us today. So let's dive into Matthew 4. Matthew 4, 8 through 10 says this. Again, and this is the third time that the devil tempts Jesus. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all their splendor. And he said to him, all these I will give you if you fall down and worship me. And Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Away with you, for it is written, worship the Lord your God, and serve only him. Good morning, Cyril. I'm glad you're with us, holding you in prayer today, too. It's good to have you back home. Okay, so our devotion today is called Only in God. And this is what Henry Nouwen says about our passage from Matthew 4. He says, Jesus' primary concern was to be obedient to his Father, to live constantly in his presence. Only then did it become clear to him what his task was in his relationships with people. This also is the way he proposes for his apostles. In John 15:8, Jesus says, it is to the glory of my Father that you should bear much fruit, and then you will be my disciples. Perhaps we must continually remind ourselves that our first commandment, what is the first commandment? It requires us to love God with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind. This is the first commandment. And I wonder if we really believe this. It seems that in fact we live as if we should give as much of our heart, soul, and mind as possible to fellow human beings while trying hard not to forget God. At least we feel that our attention should be divided evenly between God and our neighbor. But Jesus's claim is much more radical. He asks for a single-minded commitment to God and God alone. God wants all of our heart and all of our mind and all of our soul. It is this unconditional and unreserved love for God that leads us to care for our neighbor, not as an activity that distracts us from God or competes with our attention to God, but as an expression of our love for God, who reveals himself to us as the God of all people. It is in God that we find our neighbors and discover our responsibility to them. We might even say that only in God does our neighbor become a neighbor rather than an infringement on our autonomy, and that only in and through God does service become possible. I know that true joy comes from letting God love me the way that God wants, whether it is through illness or health, failure or success, poverty or wealth, rejection or praise. It is hard for me to say, I shall gratefully accept everything, Lord, that pleases you. Let your will be done. But I know that when I truly believe my Father is pure love, it will become increasingly possible to say these words from the heart. Charles de Foucault once wrote a prayer of abandonment that expresses beautifully the spiritual attitude I wish I had. It seems good to pray this prayer often. These are the words of a holy man, and they show the way that I must go. I realize that I can never make this prayer come true by my own efforts, but the Spirit of Jesus given to me can help me pray it and grow in its fulfillment. I know that my inner peace depends on my willingness to make this prayer my own. So I'm going to save this prayer for our end of time together. I want to share a little bit with you before we get there. So I've been thinking, this devotion really kind of hit my heart, because I think there are definitely times when I don't give my heart, my soul, my mind, everything to God. When I get so busy with doing what I consider ministry or service, that I forget that the most important thing is to center my heart and mind and soul on God. And here's the thing, when we do that, I know you've all met people that when you're in their presence, you can feel God's light emanating from them, God's peace kind of residing on them. I know you've met people like that. And often it's those people that spend good amounts of time focused on God, listening for God's word, centered in their daily living around prayer and around seeking God. Because when we seek God first, when God is at the center of everything we do, when God is at the center of our relationships with one another, God's peace is able to show us things that we could never have possibly seen before. And I think this season of Lent is a really great time. I mean, all time is a really great time, but especially the season of Lent, to set aside and be single-mindedly focused. I think that's how this started. No, maybe he didn't use the word single-minded. Maybe it was just in my mind. But a single-mindedness focused on God is what allows us to live out more fully our love to neighbor, our care for one another. When God is at the center of it all, we are able to do and be so much more, because at that point, we are listening for God's voice and not our own voices or the voices of those around us. But it takes an act of surrender, and we're not so good at surrendering. It takes a willingness to say, God, show me today what you want me to see. Help me lay down all the plans that I have that I might fully be present for what it is that you need me to see today. And so surrender, a hard thing for us, becomes the center of our daily walk with Jesus. It becomes the center of all that we do. We begin the day in abandon, in a surrender to what God is doing and will do through us. So I want to end our time today with this prayer, a prayer of abandon. John Wesley would often talk about giving ourselves, completely surrendering ourselves to whatever it is, in good times, in bad times, no matter what it is, that God would use each one of us, would use me, would use you for God's glory. But we have to let go of the things that keep us from having that single-mindedness. So would you pray with me? I'm going to do this in a small sections and ask you to repeat it. Of course, I don't know if you're repeating it, but I'm gonna trust that you're repeating these words as if they are your own prayer. So friends, let us pray together this prayer of surrender. Father, I abandon myself into your hands. Do with me what you will. Whatever you may do, I thank you. I am ready for all. I accept all. Let your will be done in me and in all your creatures. I wish no more than this, O Lord. Into your hands I commend my soul. I offer it to you with all the love of my heart. For I love you, Lord, and so need to give myself, to surrender myself into your hands without reserve and with boundless confidence. For you are my Father. Together, after praying this prayer of surrender, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So my friends, today, single-mindedness, your heart, your soul, your mind, let it be focused that you might hear God more fully leading you in the day ahead. God loves you, my friends, and so do I. I'll see you tomorrow.